It is 8 o'clock, so we're going to go ahead and get started. My name is Barbara Bynum, and I am one of the moderators for forum, along with Kathy Hebrews and Judy Ann Files. And Phoebe Benzinger is going to be our guest moderator in just a couple weeks. So if you have any questions about forum or you aren't on the email list, please come talk to one of us and we'll get you all set up. If you think you should be on the email list, but they haven't been coming, I can double check and we can see if maybe they can go into your junk email folder or something like that. Because I promise you, every Saturday at 6 a.m., we are sending you a new email about the next program. We do schedule it. We don't actually get up and check this. This morning, I am really excited about this. We're going to hear from Adam Turner, and he is the manager of Project 7 Water Authority. And this is the kind of thing that you might not lay awake at night thinking about: where your drinking water comes from, is it reliable, and what happens to the drinking supply if we have a collapse of the Gunnison Tunnel or a huge wildfire near a nearby reservoir. That's the kind of thing that if that does happen and you don't have drinking water, you might spend a lot of time thinking, well, why didn't anyone do something about that ahead of time? So I'm here today to tell you that someone is doing something about that ahead of time. And I think that's really exciting and proactive. So Adam has been with Project 7 for 30 years. He and his wife have been in Montrose that whole time after spending just 2 years in Denver, where he worked for the state doing a lab work as a chemist with water. And they welcomed their first grandchild just a few months ago and are about to welcome their second. They're really lucky that those grandkids are here in Montrose. And he's going to tell you all about Project 7, how it works, and the really big, exciting plans to make sure our water supply is resilient going into the future. So let's give him a big round of applause.
All right, thank you very much for that. Again, my name is Adam Turner. I'm the manager at Project 7. And Project 7 is the regional water authority. So what's happened is the City of Montrose, City of Delta, Town of Olathe, Tri-County, Water Conservancy District, Chipeta Water District, Menoken Water District. These are the six entities that we treat water for. And then you'll see that Uncompahgre is down here like a silent seventh partner. That's who handles all the getting the water from where it's naturally sourced and to Project 7. So this is the seven entities that comprise Project 7. Back in the late 70s, when they put this together, the town of Ridgeway was actually one of the original seven. But they pulled out because the time frame was too long for them and they wanted to do their own thing and get it done more quickly. So this is a map that kind of shows, this is from our website. It shows kind of what's going on. This would be the city of Montrose would be this kind of pinkish square in the middle. And then you can see the other entities are represented: Town of Olathe, City of Delta. All the brick red area is Tri-County. This kind of, I don't know what that color is, but this one is Menoken, and this would be Chipeta Water District. So that's kind of the map of the area that each one serves. And then this, all this stuff over here is kind of showing you the water sources. Most of the water that we treat, I can say, actually literally 100% of the water we treat is coming originally from Taylor Park Reservoir down through East River into Blue Mesa, and then it comes down through all the dams, and then the water comes through the South Canal. And the South Canal comes right under the edge of the Black Canyon. You guys are very familiar with that and how it works. And then we get water into a small reservoir out in the Adobes called Fairview Reservoir. And that's where we can hold about a 2-week supply of raw water that we can treat and then send to all of the participating entities through this big black thing here is supposed to be the water treatment the distribution line. It goes all the way from the water treatment plant that's just east of town, about 3 miles, and it goes then all the way back to goes all the way down to the high school in Delta. And so that's the main trunk line for all the treated water. Let's see, did I miss anything on this slide? All right. So this is kind of the history, and this goes back all the way to 1909 when the Gunnison Tunnel opened. And so that's really what made the abundant water that we enjoy today possible. You can see that in the 70s, there started to be some regional water shortages, and that there was a lot of different water treatment bottlenecks for each of those entities that I was talking about earlier. In fact, they kind of went out to find some government money to see if they could upgrade their plants. And at that time, the Farm Home Administration said, we're not going to fund all these little plants. You guys need to create this regional concept, and we'll fund one big plant. It was a great concept at the time, and we're really happy that they did that. And between 1977 and 1980, they did all of the cooperation it took to have all these, I don't think you could say competing, but oftentimes towns and cities and districts are in competition for this kind of clients, but they all got their act together, cooperated, and made one regional plan. And so in 1980, Project 7 went online. And then we've made a couple different times that we've gone and upgraded the water plant that's there. I was telling Barbara earlier, the site of the treatment plant used to be the 1934 Montrose treatment plant, and then they upgraded that in 1968, and then in 1977 through 80, it was bought from the city and rehabbed once again into its 90% of what it is today. And then over the next 10 years, we've added significant storage out there. We have 2 5-million-gallon water tanks that were put in 95, and then we gained another 10 MGD worth of treatment back in right around 2008 is when we really did that. And then you can see in about 2000, we started thinking about what would we do if something happened to the Gunnison Tunnel. And we had a lot of sleepless nights over that. We did a lot of planning with all the entities involved. And it really has morphed into the plans that we have today. And so in 2019, we started this program called the Regional Water Resiliency Program. This is kind of we've spent a couple of years trying to find what the purpose and the program values were gonna be. Again, you can read any of that on the website. Obviously, some of the things that have made this kind of brought it from the back burner of the stove to the front and center is just all the awareness that people have nowadays that just because you have a good thing today doesn't mean that it's going to be available next year or the year after that. So we've seen wildfires have really increased. We've seen drought has become more apparent in a lot of different ways. And so we recognize that along with the I don't want to say vulnerability, but alongside of what the angst that we had about something like the Gunnison Tunnel, we also started having these thoughts of what about drought and wildfire and man-made disasters and stuff like that. So this is a slide that we got from the Colorado Sun. It kind of shows that the majority of the major fires have all happened in the last 20 years. They're just getting more frequent and they're bigger every time they happen. So that's just kind of showing the importance of that. These kind of things, key benefits. Again, I want to just reiterate what a great concept it was for all the entities, the cities and districts to build one regional plan. It was a great, it was great for them to all put their eggs in one basket, and it really solved a lot of issues with manpower and redundancy in those ways. And it was very wise at the time. And now we're trying to take a half step back from that and say, but we also need to diversify and have some backup plans. And so that's what the resiliency is really all about. So we did a lot of research on that, and I just would say to anybody in the room, I always like to say that we did a lot of studying on the tunnel. It started in 1909, and the Gunnison Tunnel is very robust. As we put a lot of engineering time into thinking about our options, we really figured out that even though it would be a major, major issue if something happened to the tunnel, it's really stood the test of time, and it has had no outages in the 100 plus years it's been in service. I hate to say that without knocking on wood, but you always have to do that. But the reality is it's very strong and robust, and it's stood the test of time. What we really found was that treatment issues and transmission issues were a much more likely problem that we were going to face in the day-to-day occurrences. And so we started out thinking about a source water backup, and then we finally morphed into the project that we're looking at today, because it not only deals with the problem of getting the water from Gunnison River to the water plant, but also takes into account things that can happen in the watershed, whether they're man-made or like a fire, natural disaster. And it also takes you've got a second source now, and you've got a second treatment scheme, and you've got a whole second network of transmission pipes. So it's just much more inclusive, much broader scope. And so it's much more flexible and resilient. So what we figured out was, I was also telling Barbara earlier, Ridgeway Reservoir was always designed to have a water plant there. And back when they built it in the late 60s, they had a spot there for the water plant. But with all things, there was not a lot of push to make that happen. And so over the 40 years that it's taken to bring that dream to a reality, all that land got used in other ways. So right now, where the water plant was gonna be, there's a transmission, an electrical transmission yard for the hydropower that they put on back in like the early teens. And so we basically got kind of pushed out of that pocket that was right there at the reservoir itself. So we had to find a new site. So we looked around and we found this site that is downstream of the plant. We can get water from Ridgeway Reservoir all the way to the new plant site. And then from this site, we can also push water to all the customers down valley that are relying on the plant. And so that's another win-win in that part of the program. This kind of is a overhead look at it. You can see Ridgeway Reservoir. This is the concept of a raw water line that would come from the dam all the way to the new treatment site. And then the new treatment site would feed back through a couple miles of pipeline back to the rest of the system. What we're looking at right now is slight differences in water quality. So one of the things that we're doing here is, I can have trouble with that. That we're gonna have to soften that water a little bit. The water that we have here is called moderately hard water. So the water you guys are all used to is about 80 milligrams per liter hardness in the summertime, and it'll go up to as high as 120 in the wintertime. The water in Ridgeway is going to be about 180 to 350. And so we want to treat that to get it very similar to what people are already used to. Just because that'll also create the least amount of challenges out in the distribution system. There's also capacity there to do a raw water hydro power unit and recapture some of that electrical energy, and then we would tie into the rest of the distribution system from there. I feel like an auctioneer, I probably better speed up, but this is the property that we bought in 2019, and this is the site of the water plant would be up here on this sandstone bench up behind this shop building. The farm fields down here, our intention is to keep it as a farm or a ranch. We had to buy the whole piece, obviously, and we need this part for access right now. So once we figure out where all the pipes are going and stuff like that, we'll be able to make that stay as a working ranch that'll keep the flavor of that area. So then this would be a concept of what that would look like. As you're going down the highway, you can see that's right before the canyon gets kind of narrow down in here. And they're talking about putting a plant up here on the sandstone bench. Now, that building right there you saw in the last slide is that building. And so as a point of reference, you can see all that other stuff is projected to be built up in and behind there, below the ridge line, so nobody will see it and it won't be an eyesore. The other thing to think about is what we're proposing to build down there is about 10 MGD worth of treatment, which is 10 million gallons a day worth of treatment. What you're seeing there is actually about a 40 MGD plant that the engineers just kind of dropped in. That's what they had designed, and so they dropped it in there as a visual. So that's a lot bigger than what we'll end up with, but that's the concept. This is what it would look like from the road. Again, trying to show that it's not going to jut out and mess up the escarpment view or anything like that that upsets people. This would be looking at it more from like a drone. If you were hovering above the ranch house, this is what it would look like. And again, this is super sized. I mean, you can see that's a semi sitting there. So it's way bigger than scale. But this is, again, conceptual renderings. So then the next part is the timeline. When is this all going to happen? And I'll just blast through these. Obviously, there's been a lot of planning that's already gone into it. Now we're kind of in this permitting and design phase, and we're hoping to go to construction probably early in 2023 is what will actually happen, and then build that plant and get it started up in 2025. So that's the official calendar that we're looking at going forward. Wow, there's here. Okay. So we're looking for it to end up being about a 10 MGD plant. What I tell people is right now, in a typical winter day, the whole system uses about 4.8 to 5.2 million gallons a day in the winter. So that's kind of what we have been shooting for as a good, this could get us through any kind of a crisis. So even though we're calling it resiliency, it doesn't mean that if something happens to the tunnel on July 1st, we wouldn't have enough to have everybody still water their lawn and still have everybody do whatever they want with the water. We have to cut back to what kind of the minimal uses are, and that's what we figure is happening on a typical winter's day. Additionally, we're looking at it going to up to about 10 MGD so that we can still be able to have what we need any given day to as a baseline need for the system going forward. Now this, apologize for the small print, but there's a lot of data here. This is kind of saying what they're estimating it will cost somewhere between $50 and $70 million to build this plant and all the pipelines from the reservoir to the plant, from the plant back to the rest of the system. You can see we're looking at doing this funding through a lot of different scenarios, just what we can save and build up some reserves. And then there's a lot of, we've already committed to doing some revenue increases. bringing up what we charge for the treatment of the water. And then there's also a lot of low interest loans available, and we've already gotten one interim loan to do the design work. And then there's also EPA WIFIA loan. You probably saw in the paper that we were selected for one of the options to go forward for the WIFIA loans. And then there's a lot of grant opportunities. We've already been awarded a $25,000 grant through the Bureau of Reclamation. And then we're also just recently, last week, got included in the Montrose Emergency Hazard Protection Plan.
Mitigation plan.
Thank you, Scott. And that gets us in line to go to FEMA for some of their grant opportunities. And there's some great opportunities they're looking at just even right now for that going forward. And then there's also DOLA grants, CDBG. And then there's, you know, a lot of people have always said why maybe we need to do something like a planned investment fee. Currently, that's not favored, but there is, you know, that's part of the toolbox, and so we keep it up there on these slides. So this kind of shows when Project 7 went into production in 1980, they started treating the water at 50 cents per 1,000 gallons treated. And again, I always like to make sure that everybody realizes Project 7 is not even like a wholesaler. We take the water that already belongs to the City of Montrose, we run it through our reservoirs that we control, but we never take ownership of that water. We are just treating that water that Montrose owns for them, and then we're delivering it back to them through a master meter, and then they distribute it to their customers. And so this is just one small part of the total cost of the water. Montrose owns the water up in, you know, the reservoirs where it started. They store it, and then they distribute it to their customers. Same with Town of Olathe, same with Tri-County Water Conservancy District. So this has been our rate for years and years down here. It's just kind of gone along until we were at 90 cents a thousand back when we started this program. So for 90 cents, we treat 1,000 gallons of water to a level that's better than the bottled water you can get from Aquafina or any of those that you pick up at the store. I can say that without pause. I just it is a better product than what you buy in a bottled water. And how I can say that is that all drinking water is treated to EPA standards. They're the ones that are over top of us. All bottled water, spring waters, all that stuff is under the FDA. And their regulations are much broader. I tell people it's kind of like if you put it through window screen, it's going to meet the FDA standards. we have to make sure that it's kind of 1 micron filtration and stuff like that. So the standards are tighter. So we're proposing to make some adjustments of this rate and get it up to this red line is kind of what the engineers thought the price should have been all these years, that we've been way underselling the value of the treatment part and the distribution part. So this is some of the stuff we've also done since 2019, is we've done a lot of going out and talking to each one of the customer bases. And so we spent a lot of time talking to each board, each district, and figuring out what they see as the goals and the deliverables that we want to deliver with this resiliency program. And I think everybody, and I think rightly so, is very proud of the investment that they made in Project 7 back in 1980, so 40 years ago. And everybody's kind of got the attitude that we want to lead the next generation in a better place than what was handed to us. And so everybody's very supportive in this. Obviously, the money thing always becomes an issue, but the bottom line is nobody wants to be the generation that just drops the ball. Everybody wants to hand it off to our kids and grandkids in better shape than what was handed to us. So this is different ways to get involved. Obviously, you guys are right in the middle of that with an event like the forum. Also, there's a lot of good press on that out there. And I'll open it up for questions.
Thanks, Adam. That was great. Really appreciate it. And in terms of the city being one of your customers, our utilities manager, David Reese, is here. So if your question is more along the lines of what happens and how does the water get to your house, he can also answer those. But let's start if folks have questions about Project 7 or this new plan.
Resiliency is a nice word that's popped up a lot the last couple of years. Where does that put us, or where are we in getting some of the infrastructure money from the feds?
Yeah, good question. You know, that's what happened even a week ago when we did some public hearings and we got included in the Montrose County plan. That sets us up really well to get like FEMA dollars that are kind of going towards those kind of projects. FEMA is really excited about this kind of project because they can see that it costs them pennies on the dollar to get out ahead of these things and have a well-laid plan and get it working before it becomes a crisis. And so they've been really good partners. And all of our federal partners are kind of in that same boat. They all are seeing that this is a big deal. And we want to help people get ready for these challenges rather than have to ride in like the cavalry and try to fix it once nobody has any water to bathe with or drink.
Yeah, with the recent dry years we've had and the forecast for more to come, it's not uncommon to see UEWA put a call on upstream from Montrose to put a three-way reservoir. Where does the water rights for Project 7 stack up in that regard? Do you have some good seniority?
Well, we do. We have really good water rights. Again, Project 7 doesn't own them, so those are owned by like City of Montrose. City of Montrose has really good old rights, and all the entities have some really solid rights. I was telling somebody earlier that a lot of the water rights owned are in Ridgeway Reservoir. So there's already a block of 18,000 acre feet, which is about a fifth of all that's in Ridgeway, is municipal and industrial water. So there's a good track record there. It's a pretty solid right. That's a good question.
What's the current makeup of the board for Project 7?
Well, we have one voting director from each of the entities that were listed, except for Uncompahgre Valley Water Users. So we have a voting member from the City of Montrose, from City of Delta, Town of Olathe, Tri-County Water, Chipeta Water, and Menoken. So everybody has a vote on there. Those six entities have six votes.
Thank you. Good morning, and thank you for a nice presentation. A two-part question. One, to expand on the gentleman's question up there on water rights. Where does the city's water rights lie relative to the Colorado River compact rights? And the second part of the question is, how are you going to handle some of the challenges of the water coming into Ridgeway Reservoir as you look at the river above there? It's loaded with mine waste. What challenges do you have to deal with that? It's much, to me, the water is much more a challenge than it is what comes in out of Blue Mesa. Thank you.
Yeah, good questions. We have really good water rights. All of the entities here own some pre-1922 water rights that are pretty solid. They're about as solid as you can get. The other reality there is that the federal government, nobody really has a stomach for turning off people use of water
as opposed to the ag water. They'll always try to find a way to make that work. It's just kind of one of the realities there, that even the farmers need to drink water if they're gonna work their land. So human consumption always kind of takes priority in those cases. Not saying that they're gonna let everybody in Montrose water their yards and have, you know, the best lawn in Montrose contests, but they would definitely prioritize human consumption of the water. The second part of that is, you know, I'm a chemist by trade and have been studying this stuff for 30 years. And when we moved here 30 plus years ago, I wouldn't have eaten a fish that I caught south of town. That was just kind of common knowledge. It, you know, there's too much mine tailings, there's too much stuff in that water. Today, they've done a lot of work down on Red Mountain Pass. A lot of the mine discharges have been remediated, and we've got a long track record of studying what's in Ridgeway Reservoir. We've done quality tests up there since about 08 and have a real good track record of what the water contains. Some of the things we don't really know is if there was going to be an upset in the sediments or something like that that are in the bottom of the lake, some of the old stuff. But we will have treatment built in, and we could work around that. The other thing about it is if we have two sources, we're going to be able to kind of use more on one or less on the other, depending on how it is. So we typically wouldn't have everybody converted to Ridgeway water unless it was an absolute emergency. So you're always going to have, you know, we're going to always have the opportunity to use the highest quality water for the customers at any one time.
Yeah, you may have just answered my question, but can you clarify, is this going to be sort of just shut off unless we need it, or is it blended? Is it a blend of the two projects that will contribute the water?
Yeah, it's absolutely a blend of the two. What will happen is right now, right now about at 6710 and Ogden Road is about as far south as we can serve water right now from the current plant location. So from here down to Ogden Road, we can push water there. Anything from there south has to be pumped. And so Tri-County's pumping it up to 15 times by the time it gets to some of these places on the outskirts of Ouray. Excuse me. So our plan is not to, is to try to make this more friendly long-term and be able to serve everybody pretty much south of Ogden Road this kind of water all the time. So they'll get this water, it'll be treated to the same standards as what they're used to now, and hopefully they'll, you know, that'll make everybody real happy, and we shouldn't have to take them off of that water unless there's an issue, and we pump water up from the other plant.
So Adam, I think one key to what for me understanding it and hearing about it was the word gravity. That plant is perfectly positioned to feed the valley without spending a lot of money pumping water where it needs to go. And right now, electricity is being used to pump water up towards, like, exactly. And so that location on that shelf and the fact that that transmission pipe that will be built is all going to be, or mostly, gravity, that's a huge deal.
Exactly, yeah. And that's always given us all angst, is, you know, that we bring all the water down here and treat it, and then we pump it all the way back uphill to where it's needed. And it doesn't just, it's not sustainable. It's not something anybody really wants to do. So we're hoping to replace a lot of the pumped water with gravity-fed water in perpetuity.
Okay, I have two questions, one for Adam and one for the guy from the city. My question is a dumb question, but what do you do when they shut the tunnel down in the wintertime? Where do you get your water from?
Yeah, the water users actually drive down into Black Canyon every other week and open up that gate for about 24 hours, and we refill Fairview Reservoir.
I have a question to the guy in the city. being here on the city council and stuff, they're putting a new water pipe right on Townsend right in front of our office, and I was talking to the guy yesterday about the pipe and everything, and he said, yeah, they're replaced. I said, where's the old pipe? He pointed where it is, in, like in the middle of Townsend, but he said it's asbestos pipe, and I said, you still have asbestos pipe in Montrose? And he said, there's a lot of asbestos pipe. How did, and Adam, being a chemist, how is that harmful? I mean, I know in the air, airborne asbestos is bad, but what about in the water and the piping?
David Reese is the guy to answer that question. And plus, City Council last night just approved a couple million dollars of a whole new water transmission pipe to go across town, so we can talk water pipes all day.
Yeah. Asbestos cement water pipe has been put in the ground probably until the 70s, at which point in time the manufacturers kind of quit manufacturing it. We didn't have a lot of asbestos cement pipe in the ground because we were very corrosive, and the earlier products were cast iron pipe, and cast iron pipe doesn't last but about 20 years, and we had holes in it. And in fact, we got parts of town that were on the fourth generation of pipe. Yeah, we had wooden water mains back in the late 1800s. We went to cast iron after that. Cast iron wore it out. They went to asbestos cement, and now we're replacing them with PVC and polyethylene HDPE lines. So this is an iterative process, and we've got hundreds, we got about 150 miles of pipeline in the ground. Cost to replacing pipe is very expensive. All of the EPA studies show that asbestos in the water line does not create any health issues. It's only airborne. When we work on that pipe, all of our crews wear respirators and stuff when they're cutting that pipe and doing that type of stuff to protect the workers and stuff. So we have a very good program to do that. Again, it will take decades for us to replace all of that AC pipe that's in the ground. We are moving along with that. A lot of our projects, we look when we're doing street rehab and stuff, we're replacing water lines to try to get the water lines replaced that are underneath the street before they start failing and stuff. So that's part of Townsend, that's the process. They're gonna be milling and overlaying that road this summer. And so we looked at that and looked at our critical infrastructure and said, what infrastructure is due for replacement? And I think we're spending about $1.2 million on Townsend replacing water lines there, which hopefully here in the next month or so will be complete, and we'll be off to Townsend, and we won't be the angst of the traffic that somebody else will.
And those pipes are being completely replaced with new ones, as opposed to when we do like the lining, which we do cured in place lining on other pipes.
Yeah, and on the sewer lines, we use a process called cured in place lining. Of course, the sewer pipes are typically vitrified clay pipe, which is very brittle, and structurally, once it is compromised, is at risk. We've got lining processes that we use that put a new pipe within that, using that existing pipe primarily as a mold, and put new pipe on the inside of that without actually interrupting the street and stuff. That process will also be going on Townsend here over the next month or two to do that on all the sewer. We'll be rebuilding all the sewer manhole top ends there to the interface with the road, so we don't have all those potholes over those manholes. If you drive over, you cuss them every time. We do the same thing. You know, we're looking at them and going, okay, how do we build these in such a way where they last longer and that we're not going to have that problem, and make sure that they build that road smooth over the top of those manholes. Don't build it half inch or an inch higher than the manholes, and then you still have that pothole that then when your car tire goes over it, beats on that manhole lid, deteriorates it, and it gets worse and worse over time.
We could talk, I think it's fascinating, the cured in place linings, the pipe bursting, I mean, there's so many cool ways, and a lot of pipes under the city of Montrose.
So when you're looking at adding additional treatment facilities, you're looking at redundancy, right?
Right.
So when you're factoring in the plant, are you looking at population growth as well?
That's a tricky question. I mean, nobody wants to think of it as it's a tool for growth, and we're not really looking at it like that, but we've often said that all the entities that own Project 7 have 48 million gallons a day worth of water to treat, and right now we can treat about 28 million gallons a day of that water. So it's just kind of growing into the water rights that everybody owns. And so we've done studies, and you know, the water plant that we have right now is sufficient for anything we could need past 2030 at this point, from the engineer's best guess. And so we don't need it for growth, but it obviously will come into play, you know, down the road for that.
Here,
I thought Buckhorn Lake was part of our water system. Where does that fit into all of this?
Well, the city owns that area, but that the water in Buckhorn never comes down for human consumption. The same with, like, the city owns water out of Silverjack Reservoir. And for years now, they've been leasing that water to Foster Park, Cimarron Ditch Company up in there, to use that water. Basically, because I asked them to back in the late 1990s, the water in, like, Silverjack has a lot of aspen leaf tea in it, basically, a lot of organics. And so that water is great for plants. Plants love to drink the aspen leaf tea. But it's really hard for me to treat it. It takes a lot of extra chemical, and I have to get that tea out, even though it wouldn't hurt anybody in here. I have to get rid of those organics because they can produce other things going forward, like disinfection byproducts that we don't want to drink.
So, okay.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, so those water sources can be important for irrigation or farming, but they aren't part of our drinking water source.
Exactly. And even right now, I mean, a lot of the water that's owned by the entities that we serve are in reservoir. And the water users have been very gracious to just trade that water right with us for water out of Taylor Park and Blue Mesa, because that water's a lot easier to treat, and it's a high quality water, and we can't get the water physically from Ridgeway down here. So what happens is, those of you who are familiar with the area, the South Canal ends up coming past Fairview and dumps out way down here almost at Kelowna. And so it's good for the water users, and it's good for us to just replace the water that we can take it out here into Fairview and then release a little bit more out of Ridgeway to help keep this West Canal going over here on this side of the valley. So a lot of even though the entities own water in Ridgeway, we're trading it now just gallon for water out of Blue Mesa that comes through this system, and then they replace it with water out of Ridgeway that irrigates all the fields on the west side.
I thought it was curious at the beginning, you said Ridgeway opted out of this to do something else. And over time, I've watched Fairway Pines, the golf community, struggled to have enough water. It doesn't seem like they made a very good decision, but if they came back to you, could they ever opt into the partnership? Would you ever sell them water, or are they just fine?
That's a good question. They were going to be part of building a water plant there at the Ridgeway Reservoir back in about 2008. And they were approached again by Tri-County, and we're gonna do that. But even at that time, for other reasons that I wouldn't wanna put on tape, they don't want to commit to that process at this point. It has to do with water rights. And so they didn't have anything that they could really bring to the table in that, with a hard and fast right that they can say, okay, we're gonna dedicate this much water to the pool. And so they went out on their own and they upgraded Lake Otonawando on the other side of, up in, oops, man, I keep doing that, I'm sorry, my fingers are too fat. They have this area up in here, and let's see, I'm over in here. No, it's up this Pleasant Valley way. Lake Itanawando is up here somewhere, and so they've upgraded that plant. You're also talking about a totally other water system on Dallas Creek water for Fairway Pines, and that's owned by a different outfit. Both of them have approached Tri-County, and Tri-County does have emergency connections to both of those systems, and they've activated both of them, you know, within the last couple of years for different reasons. So Tri-County has shored them up as far as water quantity in the past years, and is willing to continue to do that. But as far as them becoming a partner in Project 7, I think that bird is flown.
Just circling back to, you mentioned water treatment and how the water coming from Ridgeway is going to have extra treatment. What does that, just because I don't understand, what does that look like? Do you have environmental concerns you need to address?
No, that's a good question. It's water softening is what we're talking about, and water softening is can be a really messy project, and that's why we had another piece of property closer to the dam earlier, and we sold it and bought a bigger piece just with that in mind, that it takes a lot more solids handling for the water softening. However, there is some new technology that we're looking at for this plant that would basically take the, it's kind of like making a pearl. You're using that the hardness in the water to really make a little pearl on a grain of sand, and you kind of build them up and take them out as a hardened product, as a little dumpsters full of these little pearl products, instead of just, you know, spreading it out massively, drying it down, and hauling that all off to landfill or something like that. So there are some better technologies now. We're also looking at, I mean, we still haven't decided on what technologies to use, but there is softening you can do just through membrane treatment. The problem with that is that the product that is undrinkable is a waste product that's treated like a brine, even though it would be better than a lot of the water people use to irrigate with now out of some of these seeps on the Uncompahgre. That water would be classified as a brine, and so we'd have to inject it down wells. So that's not something that we really, to me, it doesn't seem like a practical thing to, you know, get 80% of the water as purified water and then, you know, reject 20% of our water in these times of drought. That just doesn't seem wise.
Adam, without pictures, it's kind of hard, but can you just in general talk about what water treatment looks like? Because if I recall, like first you spin it really hard to spin out stuff, and then it goes inside, and then it goes through things. And just, can you kind of give us the big picture of what it means to treat water?
Sure. We do have some stuff on the website that will show you that. But what I tell the school kids that come out is basically our number one thing that we're trying to remove from the water is adobe dirt. And adobe dirt is just super finely divided clay, and it's so light and can float in the water. They tell me that in 1,000 years it will only settle 1 foot in the water column. So obviously what we have to do is get these little bits of adobe dirt clumped together into something that will drop out in a timely fashion. And so we add the product is called aluminum sulfate alum. We put it in the water, and it's got a really high positive charge in it, and it attracts all these slightly negatively charged little bits of adobe dirt to itself. And so now we have these dirty little clumps of adobe. And then we can take something called a polymer that can take a bunch of those little snowballs that are dirty snowballs and clump them together into something bigger that will fall out. And so we're really just trying to get all that accumulated together. So as Barbara said, we put it all in a big mixing container that just churns this water and gets everything to collide with one of these highly charged particles and then other particles to make these snowballs. And then they drop to the bottom of this container, and the good water comes up and away from it and is collected over the edges. Then it goes down through a filter, and we filter it to
a multimedia filter that basically the main thing is coal, and it's a really hard coal from back in Pennsylvania.
Anthracite
coal, and it makes a 1 micron effective filter. And so we filter it all to that 1 micron level, and then we add chlorine to kill the bugs in it. And those of you who've been here for a long time, remember we used to have more of a smell and a taste of chlorine in the water, because the free chlorine that was used to kill the bugs still reacts all the way to the customer's tap. And in 2005, we were able to put in ammonium nitrate in there, and no, ammonium sulfate, I'm sorry, and make that chloramines, which are a lot less reactive. And so after we've killed the bugs with the chlorine, we can put the ammonia in there and cause that chlorine to be a much friendlier product that will go more gently with the water all the way to the consumer's tap.
See, that's cool, huh? I think we have time for one more question.
Okay, I don't know if I can ask this right. So you have water coming from the current plant in the black pipe, black line, and then you have the new plant coming in the gray line. Do they ever meet, and how do you regulate the pressure between those two? Because like at my farm, which is actually in the city limits of Montrose, but it's Tri-County water, water comes into my farm at 120 pounds of pressure, which is like astronomical. But Tri-County says, I have to put a pressure regulator on there so I don't blow everything out. But how are you regulating that, and where do they tap in a little, maybe not getting too technical, but do they just parallel and never touch, or will they connect in to get together?
Yeah, those are good questions, Jim. What you can see here is, if this is the water treatment site from the previous, this blue line kind of represents how much pipe we have to put back in the ground to go hook back into those Tri-County mains that run up and down the highway. Back when they did the Cornerstone addition up there, they upgraded a lot of those pipes south of town to 14 and 18 inch pipes. And so those are the pipes that we'll hook into initially to get the water back to town. All that stuff about the different pressures and stuff, that's all to be worked out later. But we'll have some specialized vaults in the ground that will deal with the pressure, whether the water's going south or coming north. It'll have to be either pumped uphill or put the brakes on it going downhill. Like even that black line there, you see that we maintain, it's a 30 inch line all the way to City of Montrose, and then a 24 inch all the way to Delta. We have to put the brakes on three different times as it goes downhill there, or it would roll into Delta at 500 PSI. So you know, we just have to tap the brakes along the way, and it's kind of like a freight train. You can't just get on the brake, you know, where everything just derails up behind it and smashes. So there's a lot to it, and it'll take a lot of engineering and figuring that out.
Delta better be nice to us then, huh?
Well, you know what? Delta actually gets the short end of this deal a lot of times. If there's an outage, they're the first ones to know it. And after an outage, they're the ones who end up with all the air and all this stuff. You know, they'll have like, their water looks like 2% milk for, you know, a day after every break that we have. So they have their own issues that they're dealing with.
There we go, right here.
Just trying to figure out all these pieces to the puzzle. So up on the Hogback, or you want to call it Sunset, it says the new tower. So is that part of Project 7? Is that, no, that's city.
That's the city.
Okay, that's city. Also another question is, will Project 7's water treatment plant restrict the flow of the Uncompahgre going through town in any way? There's no restriction that it will still flow with the same?
Yes, absolutely. We looked, one of the early concepts we had, instead of hooking directly to the dam and having the pressurized water come down, we looked at just releasing extra water into the Uncompahgre and pulling it out down where that new treatment site is, and just letting the river transport the water. There's a whole can of worms that you open there, and just you lose kind of control of that water, and there's some degradation that happens as far as quality as well. And so
we're really pleased that the board has given us the authorization to pursue, you know, keeping good control of that water all the way from the reservoir. That's a big deal.
Okay, I'm going to hand it over to Judy Ann Files, who's going to tell us about next week. But first, let's give Adam a big